Whether social media is evolution or revolution, its impact is enormous. In this program, how your business can use it well and not look like the strange uncle at a Sweet 16.
The companies that elevate people within their organizations are the ones that are going to win.
Someone once tweeted, "Jeff, you should add a mic jack to your HD Pocket video camera." And they did, and we now outsell the competition 10 to 1.
You need to understand this medium, and you need to understand the benefits it can bring.
They've got the PMP, PSP, NDS, the mobile phone, the smart, whatever.
The values you define, it will define who you are today, tomorrow, and in 10 years when you're a billion-dollar company and you're flying me around on your private jet.
Later in part two, we'll be looking at measuring the impact of social media marketing on sales. But first, a challenge. How worldwide is your World Wide Web?
The real challenge is that it's still predominantly led by the people in New York or in London when they come up with ideas, and localization is a challenge because it's definitely not rooted in true insights.
According to global PR firm Edelman, all social media is local. It's language driven, and your outreach needs to be local, even hyper-local. Get that right, and even the most potty-mouthed campaigns can be enormously successful.
Well, fire investigators have not been able to flush out a porta potty arsonist in San Francisco. So tonight, a publicity-savvy cleaning company is offering some help.
They are often graffitied, and in San Francisco, someone is setting them on fire. Since November, 27 portable toilets have been torched, causing $50,000 in damage and lots of concern. Now Clorox wants to help clean up this problem.
We heard about this issue of porta potties being set on fire, and we decided we're not going to take this sitting down.
Many things about that are just great, but it led to one of our first Facebook pages, maybe the second or third, where consumers were joining and trying to help us with new puns. Have you thought about this one, they'd say. And before the end of the weekend, we were receiving email from Mumbai wondering about this campaign and how hilarious it was.
We're very fortunate that we're building a business at a time where there's a lot of free media. Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, you name it, like that is all free media. You don't have to pay a dollar to get your content out there anymore.
Whoa there, young man, can of worms time. Is social really free?
The social marketing is not free.
Ah, gotcha. So it must be earned media.
It's not truly earned media per se, it's not truly free.
The barrier to entry on social media may be zero, but the time cost of content alone makes a liar free, and that's before you add up Google AdWords, promoted tweets, etc. Guy Kawasaki famously launched a money-making website for only $12,000, but admits that was largely possible due to the 24 years he spent earning his reputation. The key, I believe, lies in traditional media marketing.
It's like a great television show. You always have new episodes.
But with a social spin.
Great brands have the ability to constantly develop new stories, new narratives, which are essentially episodes that keep your audience engaged. So the always over-referenced Apple, right? You always look with anticipation of what Apple will do next. Those are just nothing more than episodes. So it's about creating content that's contagious.
And here's where the zero cost of entry comes into play. Brands can experiment at relatively low cost and see genuine business results. For example, Method used a legal tussle to further define its green principles, and Virgin used the romance of air travel to do some, data capture.
I mean, data capture. Data capture can be so boring and linear and uninteresting. So we wanted to capture some data, some find out where potential customers were. So we ran a contest called Name Our Planes, where we invited the public to name some of the airplanes. Instead of doing first name, last name, email address, you know, email opt-in, what's the name that you want, submit, done. We did it, we had all that information, and then we said, give us your star sign and a word that describes the name that you come up with. Is it funny? Is it controversial? Is it, you know, serious? Is it ambitious? And then we put them all in a 3D space, and you could see all of the planes and the names, and you could interact with them, and you can group them, and you could vote on them. It was a very experiential process. Mm-hmm. And people really, there was like 14,500 names within a couple of weeks. 10,000 people who are mildly interested in you are infinitely less important than 100 people who are passionate about what you do.
It's not who you know, it's who they know. And this principle works on even the most business critical issues.
As an industry, we found the battery life metric that everybody using disadvantaged us. So, you know, we went and looked a bit deeper and said, why is that so? And it appears for complicated reasons. The metric was really designed off a very bad test. And we didn't think in a consumer-centric world that had any meaning at all. So we really use social media and blogs and Facebook and Twitter and all of those things to start a conversation in the industry about, is there a better way of doing it? We really got everybody to rethink battery life, and I think for the next couple of years you'll see people talk about and influence, and that conversation, which may not be visible to consumers, but was visible within the industry, changed dramatically because of that.
Of course, your influencers don't have to be external. Social media can work just as well inside the company. Online retailer Zappos.com is famous for its exemplary customer service. So it's no coincidence that CEO Tony Hsieh actively promotes Twitter as a way to bring his staff together and as a promotional tool. For Tony, it creates a shared culture where everyone is treated with the same care and attention, friend, colleague, or customer, and he's not alone.
I believe in a set of beliefs and values, which is what culture really is made of. That's how we run the company, not on a vision statement or a strategy.
For Advertising Guru, Kevin Roberts, Creative, Interactive, and Personal, is the order of the day.
I blog every day about stuff that's on my mind and all that kind of stuff, so people can read that. Saatchi has a lot of bloggers in the place. All my stuff's posted on my website and stuff like that, so people dip in, dip out. It's highly participative.
The challenge that a lot of people have is measurement.
If our fifth principle was define your values, this one could easily be called define what success looks like for you.
Is it replies? Is it page views? Is it time on site? Is it repeat visits? Is it email signups? Is it purchases? Is it all of those?
I think in marketing, if we're not careful, we've introduced so many metrics that sort of tell us everything can actually help us to do nothing. So for every marketing dollar I use, how many sort of dollars of profit do I get back? And that's how we'd sort of judge our marketing investments.
Those are just two examples, the detail or the big picture metrics, but I could have found many more. Online, of course, you can measure everything, but just because you can doesn't mean you should. Personally, I'm a huge fan of Mary O'Connell's brilliantly practical and faultlessly common sense approach.
Not in a BDA mode, but in the classic PR mode, and what my bullet points on my PowerPoint as I trot around the building is every brand that's involved heavily in social media is doing very well. The brands that are not heavily involved are seeing flat growth.
In 3 years, this will no longer be a principle for success. It will be stating the obvious.
You and I, we don't think whether we're getting a digital message or a non-digital message.
Right.
We don't really care.
According to Chuck, there are only three questions that need answering for effective marketing communication of any sort.
The first would be, you know, what makes this brand unique or differentiated? The second, I think, would be is who wants it or who needs it. And the third would be, well, how do you engage then with that consumer in order to communicate in the best possible way? I think if you're starting out by saying, you know, what's a digital campaign going to look like?
Right.
You really miss the bigger picture. We're all part of the digital world. So whether it's digital or non-digital is irrelevant. What's important is the idea and how well it engages a particular audience.